Good morning, church, and Happy New Year. Let's stand, let's go to God in prayer. I'm glad you decided to come to church this morning.
Oh, hallelujah.
I think a lot of people seem to be home celebrating or sleeping. Father, we come to you this morning, and we're so thankful, God, that we're able to gather in this place to worship and to praise you. Today, Lord, as always, we invite the Holy Spirit to come and to minister to us. Father, to touch our hearts and lives. Dear God, I pray that you'd be honored and glorified in everything that we say and do today. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Amen.
An awesome God, He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Oh, our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Rolls up his sleeves, he ain't just putting on a rich. Our God is an awesome God. There is thunder in his footsteps and lightning in his fists. Our God is an awesome God. The Lord wasn't joking when he kicked them out of Eden. It wasn't for no reason that he shed his blood. His return is very close, so you better be believing that our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. God was starless in the void of the night. Our God is an awesome God. He spoke into the darkness and created the light. Our God is an awesome God. The judgment and wrath He poured out on Sodom. The mercy and grace He gave us at the cross. I hope that we have not too quickly forgotten that our God is an awesome God. Oh, our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an more power,
Oh,
Invite the Holy Spirit to be here with us. Father, as all the different things that go on in the world, all the different words that we can say, there's nothing like being touched by your Holy Spirit. And I ask today that the Spirit would minister to each person here in the sanctuary and those who are joining us by way of internet. Our desire, Lord, is to be touched by you. We thank you, God, for all that you have done for us, for all your blessings, for all your goodness. Most of all, Lord, we thank you for our salvation. We're thankful, God, that Jesus came and gave his life for us. Thank you, God, that we no longer have to carry our sins. They're forgiven, washed away because of the blood of Christ. We thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Alas, my Savior me, and did my sovereign die. Would he give that sacred head for sin?
At the cross,
Amen.
Amen.
At the cross, where we first met the Lord Jesus Christ, where our burdens rolled away, and it was all because of what Jesus has done for us. You may be seated. And as you're seated, I'd ask that you would take your little communion cup. Has everybody received a communion cup? Is there anyone who needs one? Let's see. I will get you. Deborah, you need one. Lori, will you get one for Deborah? Anybody else need one? Do you need a communion cup, Evelyn? You have one, okay. And this first Sunday of the year, I thank you for coming to church this morning. You're missing the Mummers Parade. I'm so disappointed. There's a lot of different things that we could be doing, but what a way to begin our year. Gathered together with the family of God and knowing that He's here with us. And we are a family because of what Jesus has done for us. On the cross, our sins have been forgiven. Because of the cross, we are now a family with God as our Father. And I guess you could say Jesus as our older brother. That's pretty cool, isn't it? Sue, Happy New Year. Good to see you. So we hold in our hands this emblem, two emblems, the bread and the wine. And the bread represents the broken body of Jesus. And again, it's something we do so very often. We do this every month. And if we're not careful, we kind of becomes routine. Just something that the church is supposed to do. And I pray that it does not become routine. But that we stop and we honestly reflect and consider all that Christ has done for us. Not just in His death, His resurrection, but I mean for all eternity. What He continues to do, what He has done. What a blessing. And Jesus took bread that night He was betrayed, the Bible says. He broke it, gave thanks. Then they shared it together. He said, "This is my body, which is for you." And I wonder when He said, "It is for you," if He had just a general picture of people, or I wonder if in His mind, He could picture each one of us. He is God, you know. I wonder if down through the corridors of time, He actually saw Bob. I wonder if He actually saw you. He said, "This is for you." Or Jerry Lynn, maybe He said, "It's for you too." An old song used to say, "No one ever cared for me like Jesus." No one has ever cared for us like Jesus. That's why He died. As we share this emblem together, let's think of all that Jesus has done for us. Know the Old Testament talks about how that by His stripes we've been healed. Healing is the one aspect of our salvation. One of the aspects of our salvation I don't understand. I don't have to. I know what the Word of God says. As you pray for the sick, He says, "By His stripes you've been healed." So I'm going to keep on praying and I'm going to keep on believing. What about you folks? Father, we thank You so much for this emblem. But more than that, Lord, we're thankful for what this emblem represents or who it represents. The body of Your Son, Jesus Christ. broken and bruised for us. Yes, for our salvation, but also, Father, for our healing. And Lord, across our sanctuary today, and those who are joining us by way of internet, I know, God, for a fact that there are people who are struggling physically. There are physical needs that need to be met. So we bring these folks before you, and by faith we ask for healing to take place. And Lord, even as we share this emblem in a moment, again, we're thinking, God, and asking you for your touch. Bless us now, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. After supper, Jesus took the cup and he gave thanks. He talked about how his blood would be shed for everybody, for the forgiveness of sins. I know sometimes people say, no, let's not talk about blood. That's kind of old-fashioned. It's, folks, if we don't talk about the blood, if we don't understand the importance of the blood of Christ, we've missed it. Because the Bible is very clear, without the shedding of blood, there's no remission, there's no forgiveness. Without the shed blood of Christ, folks, we're lost. That's it. I mean, end of the story. If we're going to remove the blood of Christ from our conversation, from our beliefs, let's see, Shagun, do not renew our lease. If we remove the blood of Christ from our conversation and from what we believe, let's shut the doors and let's go home because we're lost. We've missed it. The blood of Christ cleanses us from all sin. Isn't that great? Father, we thank you so much again for this emblem representing the blood of Christ shed for us so that our sins, past, present, future, our sins are forgiven, and you will never remember them again. Thank you, God. Now, Lord, as we share this together, I pray your blessing on it. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Let's bow our heads for prayer. This morning, Lord, we pray for those who aren't feeling well. We pray for Mary, who's home not feeling well. Pray your touch upon her. We ask, God, that you would be with Sue and her family and all the relatives there. Comfort them. Bring peace, we pray. We ask that you'd be with those who are struggling with COVID. We pray for Adam, who's struggling with addictions, as well as Patrick and Mike. Help them, God, to break free from these addictions. We pray, God, just pour your spirit out upon them. We pray that Jaden's ankle would heal up. Be with Elke as she's recovering from a broken shoulder. We pray for a young man by the name of Andy who has a cyst on his pancreas. We continue to lift up George and Sean and Dr. Pete and Bob who continue to battle cancer. For Kate, for Darlene, for Linda, Donna, Larry, and Ann, physical needs. We ask that you'd be with Eric as he has a surgery, and my brother Bill, who have hip surgery coming up real soon. We pray for little Pearl and Natasha. Pray your continued blessing upon Raphael. I ask, Lord, that you would be with our shut-ins, those that can no longer make it to service because of physical problems. Pray your touch upon them, that you'd be very close to them and be with our friends in the nursing homes, the schools. We pray for revival in the churches. This morning, Lord, I pray a very special blessing upon our brothers and sisters down at the Alliance Church. We ask, God, that you administer to them grace and peace and help them, Lord, as they have to do some major remodeling, but just provide for them and bless them, Lord. We ask, God, that you'd be with our country. We truly need revival, Lord, and for the peace of Israel. Now, Father, as we continue on in the service, we just ask your blessing in Jesus' name. Amen. God's good to us, isn't he? Okay. I did, I mentioned in our prayers that we would, that God would bless our brothers and sisters down at the Alliance Church. They had, during that real cold spell that we had a couple weeks ago, they had a water pipe bust, and they've had some major damage. They had about 3 inches, I think he said about 3 inches of water in the back part of the church. Fortunately, they got it stopped before it hit the sanctuary, but it's been a lot of damage. And so Pastor Scott asked if we would pray for him. And I said, of course. I also told him, I said, if it doesn't work there, if for any reason you can't have services there, let me know. You can either join us or we'd have figured out how we can have two different services, but whatever. But you know why? Because we're all in the same business of building his kingdom. I honestly believe when we get to heaven, there will not be a special section for Living Word Fellowship. I think there's just going to be one section. And we're all going to be one family. Wouldn't that be great? Could you imagine what it's going to be like being with millions upon millions upon millions? Maybe singing Our God is an Awesome God. Les, you'll be on the drums for certain, okay? Okay. So anyways, keep the Alliance, our brothers and sisters down there. Keep them in prayer, okay? We're going to receive our morning tithes and offerings. And also remember, folks, this is first Sunday, and we do receive a missions offering. And the missions offering goes to Mike Taylor and to Don Jackson. So, Father, we thank you so much just for, again, being with us. Thank you for taking care of the needs of the church. Lord, as these funds come in, we pray your blessing upon the gifts, the givers. Help us, Lord, to use these funds wisely. In Jesus' name, amen. Shagun, were you supposed to be teaching the children today? You're stuck with me. Yeah, you just got to put up with us today, okay? But thank you for being willing. Thank you to everyone over this Christmas season. Thank you for your love and your support. Sandy and I say thank you, thank you, thank you. You are such a kind and generous people, and we really, really appreciate it. Are you ready for the Word? Okay. If you have your Bibles, and I got to thank the worship team, Cindy and Dawn, and Les, and Steve and Sandy. Thank you. Thank you very much. They really helped me out again today. I had the frog settled into my throat, and so I had to take it a little bit easy, save my voice for preaching. And I got to be careful on that, too. Otherwise, Les is going to finish up, okay? If you have your Bibles, turn with you to the book of Philippians, chapter 1. It's also on the wall behind us. It's in your bulletin. Philippians, chapter 1, verses 18 through 19. You can tell by the way this begins, we are jumping into the middle of a subject, just by the way it begins. But what does it matter? The important thing is that in every way, whether from false motives or true, Christ is preached. And because of this, I rejoice. Yes, and I will continue to rejoice. For I know that through your prayers and the help given me by the Spirit of Jesus Christ, that what has happened to me will turn out for my deliverance. Now, Lord, I thank you for the Word. Lord, as I share the Word with your people today, I do ask that you'd give me clarity of thought and speech. Help me, Father, to share the word as you would have it be shared, in Jesus' precious name. Amen. God bless you. As you're seated, let me read the text again. But what does it matter? The important thing is that in every way, whether from false motives or true, Christ is preached. And because of this, I rejoice. And yes, I will continue to rejoice. For I know that through your prayers and the help given by the Spirit of Jesus Christ, what has happened to me will turn out for my deliverance. The Apostle Paul was in prison because of his faith in Christ Jesus and because he wouldn't stop preaching about Christ Jesus. It's one thing to have faith. It's another thing to preach about it and tell people about it. I suppose if Paul would have just kept his mouth shut, he wouldn't have had so much problems. But that wasn't his nature. He was called to be a preacher, and preach he did. Wherever he went, he told people about Jesus. And he would look for places that people hadn't heard about Jesus. He didn't want to go to an established church. He wanted to go to new areas and preach the gospel of Christ. His plans to preach, to spread the gospel, were interrupted by his arrest. How many of us have ever had plans? Oh my, here's what we're going to do. How many have made plans for 2023? Has anybody made any plans yet for 2023? No? Okay. I have. Okay. All right. When the seed catalogs come in the mail, my mind starts thinking springtime, and I'm thinking about warmer weather, even though today's beautiful, and the garden. Okay? Steve and Cindy, I'm sure you're making your plans, okay? You got a couple made? Okay. Paul made plans. He wanted to preach. But he was arrested. His plans were interrupted. And I wondered, do you think he felt frustrated? Do you think he felt discouraged? Do you think he felt defeated? I mean, I've just put myself in that situation. I would have been frustrated. I would have said, God, this is not the way I drew it up. God, what's the matter with you, God? Don't you realize there are many, many people out there who need to know Jesus? And if I'm stuck here in this prison, I can't be preaching the gospel. And the days turned into weeks, and the weeks turned into months, and the months maybe years. But I don't believe Paul ever felt defeated. And as I reflected on that particular thought, do you realize that some of Paul's best works and his most enduring works took place while he was in prison? The very place where he probably would have said, I don't want to be, that's where God used him a lot. How about us? You ever been in that place where you wish you wouldn't have been there? And you come to find out, as you look back, it was a spot where God was so close to you, and it will prove to be one of the most enduring works of your life. The letters that Paul wrote, many of them were written as he sat there in prison. And today, and down through the ages, people have looked at these letters, found strength and encouragement, all because the anointing of the Spirit was upon Paul in a difficult place. Apparently, while Paul was in prison, though, others were preaching the gospel. Amen. Somebody picked up the mantle and preached the gospel, but obviously, if you read there, not everybody was doing it for the right reason. Some people were preaching out of pure motives, but there were other people who saw this as an opportunity to advance their own agenda. Now that Paul's out of the way, we can become powerful in the church. We can become leaders in the church, and we can push our agenda there. And they didn't care how they did it. And the word got back to Paul, and Paul said, What does it matter? He says, the fact remains that they may not be doing it for the right motives. The fact is, they're still preaching Christ. Whether from good motives or bad motives, Christ is being preached, and God will have his way. And so it didn't even discourage Paul that people were probably even talking bad about him. Saying things. He said, no, Christ is being preached. Philippians chapter 1, verses 15 through 17. Let me read it to you. It is true that some preach Christ out of envy and rivalry, but others out of goodwill. The latter do so in love, knowing that I am put here for the defense of the gospel. The former preach Christ out of selfish ambition, not sincerely, supposing that they can stir up trouble for me while I am in chains. And folks, there are still people who preach the gospel for the wrong reason. There are still people who fill pulpits, not because they love the Lord, not because they love his word, but because they're finding it a way to be powerful over a few people or many people, or because they want the money. And if that's the reason you're in it, you better get out of it, because that's not the reason we're here. A couple years ago, I met one of my relatives I'd not seen in quite a few years, and he asked me what I was doing, and I said, oh, I've been pastoring. Oh, really? First question out of his mouth then was this. Make a lot of money? First question after he found out I'm a pastor. Said, do you make a lot of money? And I just kind of looked at him and I said, if making a lot of money was the goal of my life, I would not be a pastor. That basically ended our conversation. But it shouldn't be about the money. You know, wherever we serve, it's because it's what God's called us to do. Even in the church, not because I'm a pastor, but even for those who are not pastors, we serve because it's what God would have us to do. And our rewards really aren't in this life. Our rewards are coming. How many have a retirement plan set up? Anybody here have a retirement plan set up? Okay. Kind of, sort of. I tell you, the best retirement plan you can have is invest in his kingdom. Invest with him. Why? Because he says he will always, always, always take care of us. Paul said, and you can see his motives in verse 18. From our text, he says, what does it matter why they preach? The important thing is, and this is the driving thing of his life, is that Christ was preached. He wasn't concerned about who did the preaching. He wasn't concerned about who got the credit. Do you know how much we could accomplish in church if we didn't care who got the credit? But sometimes we become so concerned about who gets the credit, who did this or who did that. What difference does it make? Paul says the important thing is Christ is being preached. He didn't appear to be concerned with what others said about him. Concerned about Christ. You stop and think about churches. And as I look at our congregation, we come from so many different backgrounds. Don't we? Let's just have some fun here for a minute. Let's just take a poll, okay? I'll start this thing. I have been raised Assemblies of God, Pentecostal. How many AG people do we have here? We got saved. Well, we got saved there, okay? How many got saved there? Oh, we got a handful of people. Okay. Where else have we come from? How many? Okay, Living Word Fellowship used to be. Our foundation is Baptist, okay? How many Baptist friends do we have here? Okay. How many Catholic friends do we have here? Okay. Let's see, who else are we missing? Oh, Methodists. How many Methodists, people? We got some Methodists here. Reformed Church of America. Got one, two. What else? What else? Who else? Lutherans? Presbyterian. Oh, we got a couple Presbyterians. Moravian. Valley Chapel. Wow. But you're all here because this is the best one, right? We're here because God has drawn us close together. And we fit and we work as a family. But when you stop and think about church life, one of the sad things about church life is how much time is wasted when we argue over styles of worship. How much time is wasted whether we sing out of the hymn book? How many of you know what a hymn book is? How many have never seen a hymn book? Okay. We don't have them here because we don't have pews, and they're supposed to be stuck under the chair, and they collect dust, okay, because we wouldn't use them, okay? Whether we use a hymn book or we sing those crazy choruses, whether we sing a brand new chorus or, as someone said, Pastor Jerry was asked one over when he was at Faith Discovery. Pastor Jerry was asked, what's the difference between Faith Discovery and Living Word Fellowship? He looked at the guy and said, about 30 years. We'll do them about 30 years old, and they try to, okay. What difference does it make in reality? We spend so much time arguing over what translation of the Bible to use. You don't use the King James? Hey, I'm going to hell. If the King James, and I've heard this, if the King James was good enough for Paul, it's good enough for me. Steve, you need to be educated. And people argue over this. And we stop and think. I had a guy come to me one time, because you folks know my favorite Bible translation is the New International Version, the NIV. And I had a guy come to me, and he was pretty hot around the collar. And he looked at me and said, how can you use that thing? Where did you get it from? I said, the Assemblies of God pastor gave it to me. You're kidding me. And I know. And I looked at him and I said, you don't realize what you're doing when you run down one translation of the Bible or another, because people have come to faith and they believe that the word is there. It's God's word. And I don't care if you read the King James, the New International Version, New American Standard. If you've come to know God, you've come to know Christ, that's his word to you. And how dare us cut somebody's faith apart? We argue over that. Meanwhile, people are dying, lost, while we're arguing over what translation to use, when all we got to do is go preach Jesus. And this is what Paul was saying. Come on, folks. Sometimes we argue over the dumbest things. It's not worth it. From our text, Paul says this, because Christ was being preached. And because of this, I rejoice and I will continue to rejoice. Isn't that great? How many have ever heard somebody preach Christ and they didn't do too good of a job? I've heard good sermons. I've heard bad ones. I've preached a couple of good ones. I've preached a bunch of bad ones. And some of the ones, this is the amazing thing how God works. Some of the ones that I thought were terrible, I went home feeling like, oh, man, God, I laid a square egg today. People call up and say, man, did God use that today? The important thing is that Christ is preached. And because of that, Paul rejoiced. And he says it again, I will continue to rejoice. And then he says this, for I know that through your prayers and the help given by the Spirit of Jesus Christ, what has happened to me will turn out for my deliverance. Have you ever had the scriptures where you've read the scriptures many, many times over, and all of a sudden the scripture just jumps out at you and slaps you in the face? And you go, whoa, how could I have read that so many times and missed it? Philippians is one of my favorite books. I love the book of Philippians. And this week as I was studying and reading it, this part just slapped me all over the place. Like, Rick, how could you have missed this? Even though I know it to be true. Partnership with God. Now follow me on this. That's what I want to get to. Our partnership with God. Do you know God wants us to be his partner? God's not in the business by himself. We are not in the business by ourselves. We are partners with God. Look at what he says in verse 19. Paul says, for I know that through your prayers, whose prayers? Our prayers. Through our prayers. And sometimes we don't put enough emphasis on how important our prayers are. Maybe because we don't know how to pray properly. I mean, we just pray, well, like we're talking to God. You know, yeah, I'm not a good public prayer. I don't know how to pray. I mean, I've heard a guy, he prayed to God. Ooh, you know, if you pray to God, man, that must be a powerful prayer, right? Have you heard those nice, elaborate prayers? And they sound so poetic. Oh, and we say, man, I wish I could pray like that. I know someone who's really close to me. Won't mention any names. Oh, I'm not. But she'll say, I don't like to pray in public because I don't pray real good. I've listened to her pray. You do a fairly good job, darling. People call her up. She's praying for people. And by the way, you don't have to pray to God. You can pray to God. You talk to God just like we talk to one another. It's not it's to be poetic. It's and by the way, you don't have to pray in King James English. You just pray however you want to pray. You talk to God. You do it respectfully. He says, through your prayers. Our prayers. I wondered, what would happen if people stopped praying? How much of the kingdom of God would be delayed and put behind if we stopped praying? He says, through your prayers and the help of the Holy Spirit. Two things working together. How do we support the ministry? Thinking about the church this week. How are we all going to work together to see the kingdom of God grow? Not everybody's going to preach. Not everybody's going to sing. Not everybody's going to play the drums or the piano. Not everybody's going to teach. But everybody can pray. And do we really, really value prayer? Not just for the church, but for one another. The other day, someone that doesn't go, they don't go to church here, but I, every now and then, some of you folks know this, if I have your cell phone number, every now and then I just send out a scripture. It's not on a scheduled basis. Send out a scripture here, send a scripture there. And I sent a scripture to this person. Never heard back. Well, I didn't hear back for several days. A few days go by, the person says, could you just mention me in your prayers? I have not been feeling well. What a privilege. And I will tell you, folks, when someone asks you to pray, one of the best things you can do is stop right there and pray. It doesn't have to be a long, elaborate prayer, because otherwise you say, yeah, I'll pray for you, and then what happens? We get busy and forget. The next day, the person sent me another message. Thank you for your prayers. 3 o'clock this morning, I was better. And it just hit me. What if I wouldn't have prayed? Pray one for another. The power that God has invested in his people through prayer. We can support the ministry through prayer. We support the ministry financially, encouraging one another. Let me say this statement about prayer, because I read this, I like this. To know that others are remembering you before the throne of grace, before God Almighty, doesn't that just encourage you? I'll be praying for you. Oh, man. I know people are praying for me. That's encouraging. Then this guy wrote this. He says, we cannot call anybody our friend unless we pray for them. If they're really our friend, we will pray for them. The need for prayer. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 25. Paul said, brothers, pray for us. 2 Thessalonians, Paul says, finally, brothers, pray for us. And pray that we may be delivered from wicked and evil men. 2 Corinthians, he again says, and thank you for your prayers. James chapter 5, verse 16. Listen to this one. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous man is powerful and effective. Confession to God. Sometimes we need to confess our faults to one another, especially when we've done that fault to someone else. It's a removal of walls. You know, when we confess our sins to God, it removes that wall. When we confess to someone who has wronged us or we've wronged them, it should be a removal of the wall. Brought back together. Now, I would say this in relation to people. Be careful how you do that. Because sometimes, you know, we take that scripture, says, if your brother has offended you, you go to him and you tell him and straighten him out. Be careful, because many times our brothers don't even know they've offended us. And we'll go to that person. Les, you don't know how much of a jerk you were to me the other day. And I forgive you. Man, I'm glad I got that off my chest. Thank you, Jesus. I've left poor Les in a heap over here, but I'm praising God. So, I mean, we have to be wise and use wisdom on how we do that. Am I right? Have you ever done that to anybody? Just curious, how many have done that foolishly? How many have done it? How many have been on the receiving end of it? Okay. So let us learn and let's be careful how we confess, because it's not, we're not supposed to dump a load that we have onto someone else. We want to be able to remove it. The prayer of a person in right standing with God is powerful and effective. Here's what I picture of the Apostle Paul. In the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 7, he says this, in truthful speech and in the power of God, with weapons of righteousness in the right hand and in the left. Now, I know there's several ways you can apply that, but just for today, apply it this way. We want to be victorious Christians. We want to be powerful. We want to be able to be effective. As we go into 2023, I want to see people one to the Lord. I want to see needs met. I want to see lives changed. So I look at that, and he says, with weapons of righteousness in the right hand and in the left. And so for today, in the right hand, the weapon is prayer. Right? It's a good weapon. In the other hand, what should we have? According to our text. Come our text. The right hand, we're going to have prayer. In the left hand, what are we going to have? In our text. Thank you, Sandy. Okay? In this left hand, the power of the Holy Spirit. You see him standing. Because he said, through your prayers and with the help of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit, I know that what has happened to me will turn out for my deliverance. So I see him with prayer and the help of the Holy Spirit, we're going to win this thing. John chapter 14, verse 16 and 17. Here's what Jesus said. I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor to be with you forever, the Spirit of Truth. The world cannot accept him because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he lives where? In who? He lives, in all of us? I mean, I can see the Holy Spirit living in some people. But some folk, no. Not all, only the good ones. Just the good ones, right? I mean, I'm wrong. If we've accepted Christ into our life as Lord and Savior, his Spirit dwells within us. And I know that. But you know, sometimes the enemy comes along and will say this to us. He may live in the pastor. He may live in the deacons. But no, you've messed up too much. God's not going to dwell within you. That's what the enemy will tell us. And we fall into the trap and we believe it. The Spirit dwells within us when we've accepted Christ. His Spirit comes and lives within us. Do we have the Spirit of God? Yes. He's living within us. And he will live with you forever. Jesus said that he would always be with us. Is that right? How can that be? How can Jesus be with us forever if he went away and he's now preparing a place for us in heaven? How can Jesus be with us? Say it louder. Through his Holy Spirit, the third person of the Trinity dwells within us, equipping us, enabling us, empowering us to live godly, overcoming lives in the world in which we live. The Spirit of God dwells within all of us, his believers. Philippians chapter 4, verse 13. Paul said this, I can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens me. How does he strengthen him? Through the Holy Spirit. Now, I know there's much more that you could add to that. You say, Pastor, you haven't talked about the importance of the Word of God today. That's just today. We know we need the Word of God. You have to be in the Word of God. How many watched Dr. Jeremiah, by the way, today? Did you hear his talk on the Word of God? Wasn't that amazing? If you could catch his, I'll get it all wrong. But you know what the number one selling book year after year after year after year is? It is the Bible. Do you know, and it's by a long shot. I mean, just a long shot. And then he told how many times down through history they have tried to erase the Word of God. Burned it, destroyed it, said it's gone. And here it is still the most popular book ever sold. We need the Word of God. Okay. Now, final thought on this for this morning is this. Paul said that I know that through your prayers and with the help of the Holy Spirit, that what has happened to me will turn out for my deliverance. King James uses the word for my salvation. What did he mean? Because he, whatever it was, he knew it was going to happen. He says, I know. Did he know for certain that he was going to be released from prison? Or was he talking about something else? Something else. Because if you continue reading in Philippians, he then explains, he didn't know whether he was going to live or die. He said, I don't know what's going to happen. But I know that whatever's happened is for my salvation or deliverance. He says this, whatever the circumstances turn out, However they turn out, I'll be good. I'll be okay. Circumstances don't matter. I'll be okay. God is in this thing. If I continue to live, I will continue to faithfully serve him, and that will be beneficial for you. If I die, because of my faith in Christ, I know that I'm going to a better place. I'll be with the Lord, so that works out good too. Either way, for me, it's a win-win situation. And sometimes we get all worked up over life and death, don't we? If I live, I'm going to serve God. If I die, some people will be sad. But if I died, I wouldn't be sad. I don't like the idea of dying, but I'd be better off, wouldn't I? Win-win. Paul says this, my life, my times, my circumstances are in the hands of God. He is in control. Therefore, I am at peace. I should say that again. You say, where did you quote that from? It's kind of just all put together, okay? This is what Paul believed. I believe this. Do you believe this? Do you believe that your life, your times, and your circumstances are in the hands of God? That's not very good. That was wimpy. Thank you. Amen. Do we believe that? That God is in control of our life, our times, our circumstances? We believe it. Why do we get all worked up then? Just human nature. That's what it is. Les, why do you get so stressed out? Don't you realize that God is in control of your circumstances? Yeah. But, Pastor, you don't understand. I don't. He does. Paul said, I'm at peace. However it turns out, I'm at peace. Romans chapter 8, verse 35 through 39. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep to be slaughtered. Paul understood that. And then he says this. Yet in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. Whatever we're going through, it's not going to defeat us. We are more than a conqueror. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. You see, for us, whatever 2023 holds for us, nothing can happen that will separate us from the love of Christ. In all these things, we are more than conquerors. How do I know that? Well, the Word of God says that. So with prayer in this hand, we're going to pray one for another. And with the help of the Holy Spirit, we're in for a good year. How good? That is for Him to decide. But this much I know. I want us as a church to pray one for another. Just not to be long prayers, just lift one another up in prayer. And then pray that all of us would be continually being filled and refilled with this Holy Spirit. Amen? Father, thank you so much for the Word. Thank you, God, for this day that you've given us. What a blessing to be able to be in your house, to be in your presence. I ask your Holy Spirit to fill every individual that is here today, every individual that is listening. God, help us to live our life knowing that our times, our circumstances, our life is in your hand. Fill us with your grace, your peace, we ask in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Thank you for coming today. God bless you. How many of you folks have plans for dinner afterwards? No dinner plans? I got to ask this one. Okay, because we're servers. How many are going to have sauerkraut today? Just Jerry Lynn, pork and sauerkraut. Okay, pork and sauerkraut. No pork and sauerkraut? Not for me, okay? Jerry Lynn, you're having pork and sauerkraut. Mashed potatoes. Oh, traditional New Year's Day. Okay. Anyways, folks, God bless you. Have a great week, and we'll see you on Wednesday night, and be back here again on Sunday morning. God bless you.